Hello there, I'm Ivan Doig, and this is where I work and write my books, which soon are to total 16. Well, Mr. Doig, thank you very, very much for taking the time to meet with us. And as I mentioned, one of the things we're really always fascinated with is your beginnings as a writer or reader or storyteller. There you were growing up in Montana, and none of the biographical stuff I've seen has ever mentioned about hanging out at libraries or your parents' collection of books or any of the things that would lead you to become a man of letters like you have, and I'm curious about that.
Well, George, the first thing to focus in on that is that my family was the Western equivalent of sharecroppers. Mm-hmm. My dad often worked on shares, as it was called, raising some livestock seasonally for ranchers. And when he wasn't doing that, why, he was a ranch hand, mm-hmm. and my grandmother was a ranch cook. And so, and their forebears had also been ranch workers, and I was too when I was old enough to do it, which was 15. So in those early days, we were fairly nomadic, so to speak, in the Smith River Valley of Montana around White Sulphur Springs, first of all. And there was not much money. The primary books that I remember and that I had my nose into all the time were comic books.
Ah.
And so, you know, they were...
Wait, how'd you get comic books up there in the far north reaches of Montana?
The Rexall Drugstore.
All right.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
And so no matter how close to broke we were, or whatever.
Yeah.
My dad would pony up some dimes for comic books. And, you know, I read those.
Did you get into the classics? The comic book classics is the ones I remember of.
I don't remember classics. You know, things like Plastic Man and so on were more my speed then. But that's just one angle into the lifetime of reading and writing, because I had learned to read before I ever entered grade school through my mother and I think my grandmother and maybe even my young uncles and my dad. Reading things to me when we're out on ranches.
Mm.
And so out of that came a habit for me to read simply anything I could get my hands on.
Yeah.
And so, you know, from comic books onward to newspapers and sports pages of newspapers in particular, and then on and on through life of magazines. Magazines were traded around a lot on ranches, and so there'd be old life magazines, you know, Collier, Saturday Evening Post, whatever. So it's all food for the eyes, and that accounts for the some hundreds of books here shelved in this house.
Yeah. Was there ever a character or a book or a story that you can remember as a kid that just, you know, I don't mean to put you on the spot with this, but...
No, I'm thinking.
Yeah.
I'm thinking. This is pretty much what happens here at this desk. I sit and think. But I cannot think of something particular there, George.
Yeah.
More what came of all this reading was a sense of vocabulary and language, which then translated into there's no other way to put it, me being the brightest kid in school.
Yeah.
And as some people have trick minds for mathematics or whatever, I have something like that for vocabulary tests and so forth that we would take in, in grade school and high school and so on, and onward to the tests you take to try to get into college.
Right.
And so I would consistently score so far into the stratosphere that people would wonder, has he got it written on his cuff or whatever.
Right.
You know? It was buttressed by taking a couple of years of Latin when I got into high school, learning with a marvelous teacher who was profiled in this House of Sky, Francis Tiedemann, who would outline sentences in Latin.
Uh-huh.
You know, we, not only in English class, but she also took 4 years of English from her in that,
right,
that small high school in Valera, Montana, but these couple of years of Latin too. And so how the language went together, how the words went together, how English went together from Latin, a lot of that came to me back then.
Yeah.
And that has carried on to the moment you rang the doorbell up there. I would say I'm sitting here working today on a scene in the next book set in a hobo jungle in Wisdom, Montana. And so I have around me here cards of how hobos talked in 1951, I hope. Things I've either researched or even made up or whatever.
Yeah.
As they're in the kip along the Big Hole River waiting to get jobs as haymakers.
Is it fair to share one of them on here? A word that comes to mind that you discovered in this?
Well, how about yaffled by the town whittler? Have you ever been yaffled by the town whittler? No, I don't think the sheriff ever did arrest you. He probably didn't catch you, did he, George?
Right. Nice. Yeah, okay. There you were in high school, and probably the bright kid, you didn't, was it a school big enough to have a high school newspaper that you work on? Or?
Yes, it was. Again, pretty much through the one whirlwind do-it-all teacher, Francis Tiedemann. The high school had 100 students, and that meant that unfortunately it had been just before I arrived there, which was a few months into my freshman year, previous year or two, it had had some very tall, talented farm kids who did well in class C basketball and football, eight-man football and so forth, and they'd done well enough in basketball, they had some regional championship. The school got promoted to class B just as I got there, so that meant 11-man football, and we could not field 22 boys to have scrimmage. We could field 20, and the electrical lineman who had graduated a year or so before he filled in, and the coach would find somebody else and so on. The point being, the school was big enough to compete in various ways, but we were always undermanned, outmanned.
Right.
And so we did have a school newspaper, you know, probably not much of one, of course, a yearbook.
Yeah.
And the town itself, Valier, kind of an odd town. It was connected with an irrigation company. And so it had been platted in the early 1900s to hold 10,000 people out there on the Buffalo Prairies. And it never exceeded 1,000. It's now down about half that even. But because of the irrigation company, educated people were in town to run a really very sizable and successful irrigation district. I mean, the office and, you know, and engineering and so forth. And so educated people, educated spouses and so on. And so there was also a local paper started while I was in high school. And so I was recruited to do a little writing for that as well. The Spray of Valier. So, you know, wherever I turned around, Mrs. Tideman wasn't trying to have me do something for the school paper. Hazel Bonnet, almost a single-handed staff of the Spray of Valier, would have me writing something. And on top of this is schoolwork, and by the time I was in my senior year, you know, efforts to get to college somewhere, somehow.
Yeah. Did you get a byline?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Yeah. I was the one. Well, I was trying to think whether there was any pay for working with the Spray, and I don't recall. But the bylines were actually bonus enough, I guess. So, yeah.
You did well in high school and headed off to Northwestern. Mm-hmm. That must have been quite a shift for you, going from there in the reaches of Montana to the big college.
It was my family's moonshot.
Yeah.
I had taken tests and tests and tests and applied and applied and applied until the high school principal in essence told me to cut it out. And so among those, I'm trying to think of the exact term, and I can't, but it was the National Merit Scholarship.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And so I'd taken those tests, and I can't remember the reason here, but anyway, out of nowhere, and I thought out of taking those tests, came from Northwestern the offer of a full tuition scholarship.
Wow.
Which was all of, I think, $800 a year or something in those days. But
that was amazing.
It was 1957.
Yeah.
And a board job. And so the big decision was go there or the University of Montana School of Journalism. Mm-hmm. As I tell in this House of Sky, the dean of journalism there come out to a field I was plowing that summer as a hired hand, and in his Oxford shoes, you know, the summer fellow seeping in, and to talk to me while I sat on the caterpillar, and asked me, what was I doing here, running a disker? So I did have a choice there, but I wanted out, as people that age so often do.
Yeah.
And so it took that full tuition scholarship, the board job, 4 years of washing dishes,
mm-hmm.
Low-cost housing. There was kind of a small cluster of special non-fraternity houses at Northwestern, right. Just off the campus, where caddies lived in one. There's a women's version of some kind of needy scholarship,
yeah,
folks. And the house I was in was by and large scholarship boys, young men, rambling old Edward Gorey-esque kind of place. With an air shaft down the middle and rooms of all sizes and so on. But anyway, Latham House provided shelter for about 40 of us, cheap shelter. And my folks had to pitch in everything they could possibly scare up, for the travel back and forth by train, and providing me any spending money I couldn't earn as for board jobs and so on.
Right.
So yes, indeed, it was a big deal.
Yeah,
to go to Northwestern.
Yeah,
and it worked, you know.
Yeah, look at here you are.
got a wife out of it. But
that's not too shabby. Not to mention The Distinguished Willamette Writers Award that you're about to get. Well,
that's right. We've been talking about that today. In fact,
that's so exciting. Right. Was there any story that we worked on that you stands out when you were a student?
Well, yeah, there are a couple of things I can relate. Is that I sold my first freelance. Two or three things I can relate, actually.
Yeah.
I'll try. I sold my first freelance piece when I was either, I think I was a college sophomore, a very short piece. I can't recall entirely what it was about. To I think a Milwaukee publication called Country Beautiful. But probably more.
Okay, I gotta ask. How much did you get for it?
Yeah, I think I got $50.
No kidding, that's a lot.
Yeah, it was, You know, later as a full-time freelance, you know, I wrote things that I didn't bring a hell of a lot more than that.
Exactly, yeah.
Within the School of Journalism, there are two more pertinent things I wrote. One was in a reporting class. Taught by one of the, they didn't call them adjuncts, but Northwestern would pull in big time professional journalists to teach their labs, mm-hmm. reporting labs and so forth. And so I think this is probably junior year. I'm in a reporting lab taught by Sam Jamieson, who went on to become the Los Angeles Times correspondent in Tokyo for a couple of decades. Terrific Northwestern grad himself and so forth. And I think the first thing I wrote there had something to do with sports or something of that sort. And I know Jamieson looked it over and thought, aha, yeah, well. And so the next time around, he assigned us obituaries. And he had what he thought was his sports nut on his hand. And so he assigned Robert Frost to me. Well, I just ate that like turkey at Thanksgiving. And, you know, I researched the bejesus out of it. I knew some of the poetry. I had enough writing skill at that point to pull this together. And so, you know, I'll never forget that the A superb job.
Wonderful. Wonderful.
On the top of the first page of that from.
Yeah.
And smooth sailing and attention from Sam Jamieson and so on then. And the other, one other quick story. Northwestern began its own in-house magazine to show off student writing, faculty, research, and so forth. And so I had done a term paper on McCarthyism. And so in the very...
At the height of it.
Well, it's a little past then. This is, you know, this is about 59 probably. Okay. But, you know, it's still...
Yeah.
Not that far over back in the over the horizon there, and so in the initial issue of Ad One, I believe I was the only undergraduate to have a piece in there. So, so these are all things that you know, I don't know if you were in the military as I was, but it's stripes on your arm,
and
they don't hurt.
So, yeah, stripes in your arm and scars on your forehead, I'm sure.
so those kinds of things.
So you were hell-bent for journalism by then.
Yes. Yes, I was. When I got to Northwestern, under the tutelage of, again, a colossal stroke of luck, which really worked, I had an advisor named Ben Baldwin, a former radio newsman of Mutual and the old Mutual Network in New York. He'd been, in fact, a producer or something on the Mutual Game of the Day, the baseball game, which is the daily feature, which my dad and I had huddled around the battery radio out in the middle of the Blackfoot Reservation when we're herding sheep, to listen to, as long as the battery would hold out.
Yeah.
And so through seeing Ben Baldwin's achievement, and who knows how much he nudged me, but I was a radio television major, news major. And of course, that meant, you wanted to be some version of a Murrow boy.
Yeah.
And so I took the news, broadcast news writing courses, along with basic reporting and various other really craft courses taught by journalistic artists. And so learned to write to deadline, broadcast deadline, learned to write tight, learned to deliver the stuff, into a microphone.
Yeah.
Out of that did not come ever a broadcast job. The military, military service, among other things, interrupted that, and it turned out that my life was going to be in journalism was going to be in print rather than on the air.
But lots of valuable lessons, I'm sure that.
I think so.
Yeah.
I think so. The sense of being around, the great reporters of the spoken word as well as the written, I'm pretty sure stuck with me.
Mm-hmm.
The sound of words on the air.
That's what I was
is,
looking for.
Something that I think I still try to translate into the sounds of words on the paper.
You have a rhythm in your languaging that seems different.
Yeah, that's a good part of it.
Yeah.
A love of poetry, some tinkering with poetry when I was in graduate school out here at the University of Washington in history. Is behind that too, I think.
Yeah. Oh, you lost me there. I have to go back. Your love of poetry and all, while you're doing a doctorate in history.
Sure.
Those seem somewhat antithetical, actually.
You've got to keep saying somehow. When you come out of a seminar room. Yeah. I was hopelessly a writer of some kind at that point. And I was learning in the 3 years I spent getting the PhD in history that I was not cut out to be in seminar rooms and on a faculty meetings still give me something like jet lag. And so you hardly ever find me in a meeting of any kind.
I really have to ask, because you're right at that point in the late 50s, early 60s, in the beat movement that's taking place in the poets like Lawrence Ferlinghetti and Rex Rutherford. Were they of any influence on you?
Well, Coney Island of the Mind.
Certainly was a wonderful
thing to behold.
Yeah.
For anybody working in writing.
So different.
And I should put in too that folk songs of the era. That language and that sense, which is now derided as Kumbaya, which is one of my favorite songs.
Yeah,
it's going to stay that way. I don't care what is poked at it. That sense that how you say things really counts. Counts to the soul, as well as to the eye or the ear.
Yeah.
I'm sure I picked that up. Carol and I both picked that up in our time of, listening to Peter, Paul, and Mary.
Oh, yeah.
Baez.
Yeah. And Pete Seeger.
Yes, and I go back to the Weavers.
Yeah.
Kind of unknowingly, but when I was a kid with my dad in the bar rooms, White Sulphur Springs, Good Night Irene was perpetually on the jukebox. And so I was listening to that movement many years before it happened.
Wonderful. As an aspiring and practicing journalist, you must have developed some real habits about your writing. You talked about deadlines, and obviously journalists have to have a discipline that poets don't, because they just wander around scribbling stuff on scraps of paper.
Mm-hmm. I'm waiting for the lightning to strike you. I'm hoping. I'm wishing for it. Some of the habits come out of the way I grew up on the ranches and in small towns, and as I say, in the near sharecropping version of that we were in the American West, that there were chores to do, and by damn, you had to do them, and you often had to do them pretty much on time.
Yeah.
You don't want a cow that needs milking out there in the corral letting you know about it, bawling by the hour.
Mm-hmm.
You can't get to the things that a ranch really runs on unless you do the small things that prop it up. The chickens, the pigs, the firewood, maybe carrying water. A lot of places we lived, particularly in Ringling, we had to pack our water from the neighbor.
Yeah.
A neighbor's house. I paced that off for this house's guide. I'm not sure, but I think it's 70 paces away.
Mm-hmm.
Try that in the middle of winter with a bucket of water in each hand through snow up to your knees, but it's got to be done. And so I still, a quick interim story here, detail, when I went in the military, I was through the Air Force Reserve. When I was in Air Force School at Wichita Falls, luck that you turned out to be luck. Sure as hell couldn't tell it when it was happening. I was assigned to the 6 a.m. version of the 6-hour schooling we were in, which meant we got up at 3 a.m. And so you had to shave, get the barracks gig free for inspections, do every damn thing before march to chow, march back, before going into a classroom at 6. And so, I taught myself to wake up, a little ahead of 3 a.m. Well, I still do quite a bit of that. I'm still up very early, always have been. And so that's part of the habit that I have developed, I would say. As to small things, maybe they're not small things, in the actual making of pages and words, I don't know that I have much to contribute that other people don't know. Sometimes stop at a good point where you can pick up the next day. I've just done that.
Mm-hmm.
I think Hemingway maybe commented on how he did that.
Mm-hmm.
Things of that sort.
One
of the oddities, I guess, is that I don't write consecutively necessarily through a book or even the day's getting of the number of words. If I'm stumped on something, maybe I'll go somewhere else in the manuscript, write a snatch of dialogue, a bit of weather, a bit of a physical description on someone, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But the point is to get the words to add up.
Mm-hmm. You know.
So do you work on one manuscript at a time?
Yes, one book manuscript at a time, Sally, yeah. I have other things around, you know, that... I hope we'll go to future books, and so on. So, you know, I accumulate in file folders and file cards and so forth, things toward that. But in terms of the actual writing, it's pretty much stick to the 1 2-year marathon. You don't want to be running sprints in the middle of them.
And do you write on that typewriter?
I rough things out on it, and so it's for me. It is more finger and mind friendly and eye friendly than the computer, and so I do rough things out on it. There's some pages here that look almost like poetry. As I will get something down and then think of another possibility, you know, move the carriage a bit, put in that rough, move on, and so forth, and go back with, you know, pencil or whatever and see how you want to frame that together. And I know it can be done on a computer, but for me, as maybe an old journalist or whatever, it is simplest to be able to pack it around, take a pencil to it, not have to be, you know, be scoring it for emphasis on the computer screen and dabbling with it there. It's all right here on a sheet of yellow paper, which has come out of this.
Yeah, going from journalism into journalism, going into the military and working as a journalist, and then going to do your PhD in history, there seems to be a bit of a chasm between that world and the world of fiction. When did you start thinking about that world?
Yes, I never had thought of it until I had... very nearly my first two books, two nationally acclaimed pieces of nonfiction, one of which came within one vote of the National Book Award, and the other, which was in the final pool for the American Book Award, Winter Brothers there and This House of Sky earlier. But in the course of writing Winter Brothers, the research, I came across this 10-inch newspaper article in the Olympia newspaper in 1857 here in Washington Territory, in essence saying the correspondent up at Shoalwater Bay, as it was then, at Willapaw Bay, in north of the mouth of the Columbia, correspondent saying, it might be of interest, Mr. Editor, for you to know that we have found two men in canoes, and they have come down from Sitka in the worst of winter. You know, I'm told the story here a little bit. And it concluded with their names, and they are of Sweden. And I was researching James G. Swan, pioneer diarist, total piece of history, you know, pure historical research at the time. But I thought, geez, I'll hang on to that. I don't know why I thought I should hang on, but I did.
Yeah.
So I ran a micro copy off microfilm, as it was done in those days. And with Winter Brothers about to come out, and always am in the habit of, you have to be, I think, as a working pro, of being onto the next book by the time the finished one is on its way through the mm-hmm. 9 month or so pregnancy at the publishing house. And so I had this story of these guys who had come down from New Archangel, as it was then, as Sitka was then. And I could not find very much more about it. And I thrashed around a little bit. And at some point, you know, the brain is up there for something. And it dawned on me, God, I could write this as fiction. Yeah. And it became The Sea Runners.
Yeah.
It was not easily done, I should say. It cost me my publisher.
Who didn't want you to turn skip
exactly
the dark side.
Exactly, yeah, right. However, on the basis of, I'm not sure, well, I suppose on the basis of This House, This Guy, and Winter Brothers, I was picked up through my agent's efforts at Athenaeum, very inventive literary publishing house of the time, mm-hmm. one of the smaller houses, and told to go ahead. And I did.
Nice. And that began your career as a real writer, as opposed to a novelist.
It did indeed. Yeah. Sea Runners was one of the, in those days, the New York Times picked, the best 100 books of the year or something, and so it made that list.
Yeah.
And my editor of the time was canny enough, we got each other enough, that he bought, in more ways than one, my next idea. By then, let's see, Sea Runners came out in 82,
right.
So I'm talking to him in, am I right there? Yes, 82. So I'm talking to him roughly in 81, and I don't know how much I spelled it out to him, but he got the drift anyway. That I thought, I want to spend the rest of the decade writing three novels which will cover the 100 years of Montana's statehood.
The trilogy.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he went for it.
Book by book, by the time I was on the third one, Moriah, Montana, Athenaeum had been gobbled up and vanished, and so it was done by the larger publishing house. But it launched me into the trilogy, and then
We are grateful.
Yeah.
And then the nimble work publishing house beyond that is publishing changed to where I am currently at Riverhead in the big Penguin family of imprints, with an editor I have followed through three publishers.
Mm.
Wow.
You've seen some changes in the publishing industry.
A few.
Yeah.
I'm not much of one for giving advice.
Mm-hmm.
Today's generation of younger writers, by and large, I guess, are going to have to do it in the digital world one way or another. And that's not my world. I don't know that I have any real savvy to pass along to them if they're going that direction. It's as foreign in essence to me as my experience of being able to turn out 16 books in a row with the blessing of an editor in a publishing house every time, and never suggesting that I do anything except what I wanted to do.
Nice.
So, I don't know that they can ever attain that, and have these 16 hardback items that are going out into the world and sell for enough to support more or less publishing house, the bookstore, and the writer.
So it turns out those comic books have paid off after all.
I would say so. Those dimes from your dad are a hell of a good investment.
Have you noticed anything in... I mean, I have to ask, your writing in your books are dense. They're lovely.
Yes.
And I love it. You have to work to read and understand and get the picture.
Exactly so.
And like the greats. And yet, more and more I keep hearing about flash fiction and this short stuff that seems to be popular with the younger people. I'm worried that we might be not losing our ability to tell stories, but changing our ability to think of stories. Does that even cross your mind at all?
Oh, sure. I think it's happening. What is the phrase that the world, society is being seduced by? The dazzlingly designed contraptions of cerebral waste.
elegantly put.
Some scientist elegantly put it that way.
Yeah.
And so Karen and I's old journalists see this all the time, and the shrinkage of not only of journalistic outlets, but journalistic product, to call news that. So yes, it's happening, and I it's not to my taste, but I think supposedly some kind of a jackleg historian, I think I can just see and say that this is a societal change, as the Industrial Revolution was, and as the explorations to the Americas were, and on and on. So
I've always been fascinated with those writing habits.
I am too, actually, yes. We've got around here some old Paris reviews and things of that nature, and I've talked with close friends. I don't talk to every writer about it, but one of our closest friends was Jim Welch, the wonderful writer in Missoula out of a Blackfoot background, reservation background. And Jim is married to Lois Welch, professor of English at Montana. They're both like us, almost same age, you know, and professor wife has supported the writer for all these years till the writer finally made it, you know, and we like the same things, and know a lot of the same people, and Jim and I are out of very much the same background.
Yeah.
You know, I'm the only other writer I know of, besides people like Jim, who's lived on a reservation for a considerable time, three summers worth. And so we had all these similarities, and finally I thought, well, gee, Jim, what's your writing schedule? He says, well, he says, I start after midnight, maybe 3 a.m., and you know, and then he would sleep.
He would
write through the night and sleep while I'm getting up and going into my cycle. We got to look at it. Well, between us, we damn near covered the clock here. So we were totally opposite in our circadian rhythms.
Yeah.
But
funny.
Great likenesses in every other way. Yeah. So.
Well, Ivan, thank you ever so much for taking this time out of your day to...
Well, I appreciate what you folks are doing.
So. Oh, it's just, we're really pleased.
Good.
Thank you.
All right, good.
All right.